It was the midnight of November 3rd, 1988. Two fishing boats carrying over 80 armed mercenaries left the Sri Lankan coast and headed towards Mali, the capital city of Maldives. The leader of the group was Abdullah Lutufi, a Mali native. His intention was to perform a coup and seize power from the government. The particular date was carefully chosen after months of planning. As a prominent businessman from Mali, Abdullah Lutufi was associated with many powerful people from across the globe. His ties with the head of People's Liberation Organization of Tamil Elam, Uma Maheswaran, was one such association. Uma Maheswaran was a former LTTE member and had been gearing to smuggle weapons, gold and narcotics into Maldivian islands. He convinced Lutufi that seizing power in Maldives would be a cakewalk given that their military was very weak. The plan was to overthrow the then Abdul Ghiam government and institute Lutufi as a sovereign power. Uma Maheswaran would then be rewarded with the opportunity to set up his base in Maldives. Maldives is a small independent island nation located in the Indian Ocean, merely 600 kilometers away from the southern coast of India. Though over 1,200 islands from this country, only over 200 have human inhabitation. Mali, the capital city, is merely 5 square kilometers in area and is just 1.5 meters above the sea level. It is also one of the most densely populated cities in the world. Once a British colony, Maldives gained independence in 1965 and chose to become a republic. Abdul Ghiam, who had been the president since 1978, was re-elected for his third term in 1988. There were multiple attempts at coup in Maldives. Given the weak nature of its defense force and its secluded geographic location, 1980 and 1983 also witnessed multiple failed attempts at coups against Ghiam. But the 1988 attempt was different. Lutufi and his squad had chalked out the mission extensively, dividing the strike into three phases. Avoid resistance from the Ghiam administration by capturing the headquarters of National Security Services. Seize the administrative center of the country, the president's palace. And finally, block all external touch points and communication channels, such as the airport and all audio-video broadcasts. November 3, 1988. By around 5 a.m., the fishing boats reached the coast at Mali, one at the presidential harbor and another at commercial harbor. Attackers disembarked and started terrorizing the inhabitants all through the city by opening fire. One group headed to radio and television centers in the city, but could not get past their gates. Another group charged towards the presidential palace to seize control. President Ghiam was believed to be traveling to Delhi on the day for a meeting with Indian Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi. Lutufi's idea was to seize power in his absence, but the meeting got rescheduled for a later date, and the president decided to stay. This is where Lutufi's elaborate plans went haywire. As planned earlier, a group of attackers moved towards the NSS headquarters. Mali had less than 2,000 national security forces protecting it. They also assumed the roles of Maldives Army, Air Force and Police themselves. At the time of the attack, though the NSS building had over 200 personnel, lack of training and poor experience rendered their resistance futile. Mali was thus seized by the attackers in the coup. Fortunately, Abdul Ghiam managed to escape to a safe area, away from the attackers. Meanwhile, the Maldivian Foreign Affairs Minister Ibrahim Zaki was requesting assistance from the international community over phone. Pakistan and Sri Lanka refused to offer assistance, citing their inability to help at short notice. America responded by informing Zaki that by the time their forces reach Maldives from their Diego Garcia base, it would be more than 2 days. They suggested Zaki to approach India for the help. Britain also suggested the same. This is when Zaki pleaded India to intervene in Maldives. As Zaki made the call to the Prime Minister's office, PM Rajiv Gandhi was returning back to Delhi from Kolkata after an official commitment. The Prime Minister's office proactively engaged with Zaki and extracted as much information on the situation as was possible. The PMO contact warned Zaki not to disconnect the call at any cost, as he was worried that the Mali telephone exchange might already be under the control of the attackers. Light going off while disconnecting the call may give Zaki's location, thus endangering his life. Also, an attack on the exchange meant Mali would truly be isolated from the world. For these reasons, the phone call that Zaki made to the Indian Prime Minister's office lasted for over 18 eventful hours. As soon as he reached the capital, Rajiv Gandhi called for a high-level meeting where it was decided that an Indian military intervention was the only solution. Many of his advisors opined that the conflict in Maldives was an internal matter that did not warrant Indian intervention. However, Rajiv Gandhi was well aware of the fact that the Indian Ocean region where Maldives is located was a region of a strategic importance to India. This route housed one of the busiest sea routes in the world. Rajiv Gandhi was determined to help the island nation. The responsibility to carry out this mission was handed over to the Para Brigade. The surface of coral reef resembles that of a cactus plant, and islands across Maldives were made up of such reefs. Hence, the operation was named Operation Cactus. Indian Army's Para Brigade is well trained to use parachutes to land on enemy territory and carry out missions. By 5 pm, over 400 Indian paratroopers boarded with two Aleutian 76 airlifters and headed to Mali under the leadership of Brigadier Bulsara. The details of the mission were top secret. From the Para Brigade headquarters of Agra, the aircraft flew straight to Mali. This was communicated to the air traffic control as merely routine flights to Thiruvananthapuram to avoid any delay in readying customs and immigration clearances. As the aircraft kept flying and eventually flew out of Indian airspace, the ATC staff at Thiruvananthapuram was bewildered. On the way, a British commercial aircraft encountered the IL-76 aircrafts. Soon, stories flashed across BBC that Indian troops are heading to Maldives for a rescue operation. While viewed from above, the Hulul airport in Mali resembles an aircraft carrier. The airport was situated in an island next to Mali and had only one single runway that was just 3 kilometers in length and 500 meters in width. Back then, India did not have access to technological aids such as satellite imaging or accurate maps of Mali. There was also grave uncertainty about the situation in Mali, including the number of attackers and the arms that they possessed. It was also possible that the other attackers posing as tourists may have infiltrated the city much earlier. It was rumored that the attackers were carrying powerful weapons such as machine guns, grenades, and even surface-to-air missiles. On the top of these, it was not even clear if the airports were already under control of attackers. Thus, landing the aircraft was extremely risky. Though the initial plan was for the troops to parachute in, winds blowing at over 20 kilometers near the coast made this impossible. The paratroopers could be blown away into the sea. Given that each soldier carried a parachute weighing 30 kg and other heavy weaponry, swimming to the shore would have been impossible. So the alternate plan of landing the planes at Hulul Airport was chosen. For this, a secret code Hudia was communicated to the Hulul Air Traffic Control. As the airports approached the one, Group Captain Ananda Gopan Vibhor, whose aircraft led the way, sent across messages to ATC. "Don't be alarmed, we are your friends. Go ahead," replied Mali. Next, the captain inquired if they had something to pass on, to which the reply was, "Hudia, Hudia, Hudia." This was a secret code to a safe landing. However, this was still risky. What if the control room was saying at that gunpoint? If so, the moment the plane landed, there would be attacks on them. Captain Vibhor prepared to land. As it was pitch dark outside, he requested ATC to switch on the runway lights for a brief 10 seconds. As the lights flickered on, Captain Vivar corrected the aircraft's position, and by the time they touched down on the runway, the lights were off again. Since there was uncertainty on how long the runway was, the captain stepped on the brakes while the aircraft engines were put on reverse. It was only much later that he realized that the aircraft had moved past the runway. Inability to nail the landing in the first go would have tipped off the attackers, endangering the mission. Via the cargo door, paracommandos assumed firing position. The next aircraft followed suit. By midnight, Hulul Airport was completely under the control of Indian forces. The troops had two main objectives: find President Guillaume and ensure his safety, and defeat the attackers. Shielded by the dark, the commandos left for the Mali in few boats from the Hulul Airport. Meanwhile, the attackers had already looted the Male Central Bank and killed more than 19 people. They continued to terrorize the city while the citizens cowered in fear and tried to stay out of harm. The Indian troops that disembarked at the presidential jetty charged to regain the NSS headquarters from the hands of attackers. This was an easy feat as they faced little to no resistance. President Guillaume, who was safe in a secret chamber at the presidential palace, was found and rescued. The next task at the hand was to capture all the attackers. Realizing the true strength of Indian Army, many attackers surrendered immediately. Lutfi was still nowhere to be found, and Indian Army started combing the capital. This was when the army noticed the MV Progress Light, a Maldivian freighter ship, was departing the commercial hub. Lutfi was on the cusp of escaping Mali by hijacking the vessel. The ship had more than 70 attackers and 7 hostages, including the Maldivian education minister. Captain Bulsharaf immediately gave nod to attack the ship. The Indian Army fired at Progress Light using rocket launchers, machine gun, and even small arms. The damage inflicted on the ship's hull resulted in an absolute loss of control and meant the ship could only travel forward. But it managed to get out of operational range of weaponry that Indian Army was carrying at that moment. At the time, an American carrier battle group was just 3 hours away from the Maldivian coast and offered help to India, but the Indian forces did not need any assistance from anyone. They had already completed their mission, so the Mali administration did not grant permission for the Americans to approach Maldives. Soon after, President Guillaume personally called Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi to thank him for saving himself and his country from the coup. But the Operation Cactus was not complete. Rajiv Gandhi tasked the naval chief with the mission to track down Progress Light, capture Lutfi, and rescue the hostages. On November 5, by 4:30 a.m., Brigadier Bulsharaf had already communicated the coordinates of Progress Light to the Goan naval base and the direction it was heading. An IL-38 patrol aircraft of Indian Navy then spotted the ship that was headed towards Sri Lanka. As it flew low to ascertain that they had the right freighter, Lutfi was alarmed. He tried to steer the ship away but failed. At the time, INS Betwa and INS Godavari were nearby. When the Sri Lankan Navy was informed of the course of Progress Light, they responded saying that the instruction they have received was to destroy the ship if it crossed the Sri Lankan maritime boundary. Indian Navy had to stop Progress Light before this could happen. Soon, INS Godavari intercepted MV Progress Light. INS Godavari's captain, S.V. Gopalachari, could speak Tamil and ordered Lutfi to surrender instead. Instead, Lutfi killed 2 hostages and taunted the Navy of further casualties if they were followed. The Indian Navy never forgives such an attempt to intimidate and would not tolerate such recklessness. Captain Gopalachari ordered an attack on Progress Light. The 30mm NT aircraft gun in INS Godavari rendered a part of Progress Light completely damaged. The sole lifeboat was also destroyed. Some attackers tried to escape by jumping into the sea, but they all were caught and the hostages were rescued. Operation Cactus was successfully completed. Indian Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi had been closely observing the progress of the mission. The attackers and the hostages were transported to Maldives in INS Godavari and safely handed over. Though the initial judgment was capital punishment for Lutfi, it was later reduced to life sentence upon India's suggestion. Operation Cactus was an iconic victory. Not only were all the attackers captured and hostages released, India suffered zero losses in the mission. The then British Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher, as well as the US President Ronald Reagan, publicly applauded India's timely intervention. Even though India was known to be closer to Soviet Union around this time, America declared that the Indian government's commitment and capability in protecting the democracy of Maldives was commendable. Even the top officials of the Pakistani forces viewed that India's timely intervention in awe. Operation Cactus was a perfect demonstration of the capabilities of Indian forces. It involved the perfect coordination of Indian Air Force, the Navy, and the Army in a seamless fashion. Every Indian can be proud of this. Jai Hind.